it. In chapter number 25, Surah Al-Furqan, verses 15 and 16, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a verse which tells us that we should interact with the Quran when we are reciting it. Not to recite it A to Z quickly, but when you read a verse, to stop and to interact with that verse before moving on to the next verse. A ayah of the Quran tells us this, and then we will see how Ahlul Bayt alayhim wassalam practiced this as the very first technique. And we'll explain why it is the first technique in a second. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states within the Quran, chapter 25, verses 15 to 16. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Qul, say, meaning that you and I are obliged to state this. We are being told by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, just as the Holy Prophet of Islam was saying, state this. Qul, أَذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ أَمْ جَنَّةُ الْخُلْدِ الَّتِي وَعِدَ الْمُتَّقُونَ. Say, is this dunya, is this better? Or is the everlasting garden better, which is promised to those who are muttaqi, those people who are God-conscious and hold fast to taqwa and piety? Is this world better, or is everything that will come in the hereafter to be better? كَانَتْ لَهُمْ جَزَاءٌ وَمَصِيرًا. That shall be a reward and a resort for them. The paradise will be a reward and a resort for those people who are muttaqin. لَهُمْ فِيهَا مَا يَشَاءُونَ خَالِدِينَ. They shall have therein whatever they desire. And now in this last part of the verse, it tells us that we need to interact with the Quran. And we will come to how Ahlul Bayt alayhim wasalam did this. Is this world better, or is the garden better? The one that you are promised for those people who are God conscious. They shall have therein whatever they desire. كَانَ عَلَى رَبِّكَ وَعْدًا مَسْؤُولًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala concludes and says, it is a promise, this akhirah, this jannah, it is a promise which is proper to be prayed for by your Lord. It is proper for us to pray for the jannah from your Lord. It is proper to do it. Now, this may seem a really innocuous verse. It may seem very obvious. It may seem, well, of course it's proper to be prayed for. I mean, who doesn't pray for Jannah? Isn't that all we do? Don't we come here, we recite long du'a, al-iftitah, kumail, layali al-qadr. What do you mean? Why? What do you mean it is proper to be prayed for? Yes. However, the way this verse is talking to us, it is telling us that when we come across a verse of the Quran, when we come across a verse speaking to us about heaven or hell or anything, it is proper that we stop at that verse and interact with that verse and pray for that thing that is mentioned within the verse itself. Now, this is mentioned to us on a multitude of occasions by the Ahlul Bayt, salawatullahu salamuhu alayhim ajma'een. And you will see their emphasis on this practice, not only in theory, telling us we should do it, that we recite a verse, stop, pray through it, think through it, that they themselves used to do this practice constantly when they recited the Quran, which tells us this is the proper way to recite the Quran itself. As an example, a hadith from the sixth Imam, Ja'far al-Sadiq, salawatullahu salamuhu alayhi, he says in Surah Al-Kafi, volume 3, page 301, also mentioned in the book 40 Hadith, or 40 Noble Hadith on the Quran, published by the Islamic Education Board of the World Federation, the Hadith says the following: surely the Quran is not to be read in a rushed, quick manner. The Quran is not to be read in a rushed, quick manner. Rather, it should be read in slow, measured portions. Whenever, the hadith says, whenever you reach a verse which talks about heaven, stop at that verse And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should be asked for the bounties mentioned in that verse. And whenever you reach a verse which speaks about the hellfire, stop at that verse and seek protection from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the mentioning of those verses of punishment. Very simple. What did the verse say? Is this world or akhirah better for you? It is proper to be prayed for. The sixth Imam states in this hadith, whenever you come across a verse which speaks about heaven, stop and ask dua from it, through it. When you see a verse of hellfire, stop, ask through it. Why? Because rather than being passive in your recitation of the Quran, you would be interactive with the recitation of the Quran. The autopilot wouldn't be taking over, the heart would be taking over, presence would be taken over. One hadith that you narrate, or one hadith that you understand, is better than 1,000 that you narrate. One ayah of the Quran that you have understood is better than 1,000 that you read. Let's just see now, inshallah, how Ahlul Bayt alayhim wassalam themselves used to do this practice. The first hadith comes to us from Aisha, the wife of the Holy Prophet of Islam, Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Aisha narrates, I would wake up with the Holy Prophet at night and he would recite from the chapters of Al-Baqarah, Ali Imran, and An-Nisa. And when he came to a verse that gave glad tidings of the Akhirah, he would stop, he would supplicate, and he would hope from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be given the glad tidings of Akhirah. And when he came to a verse that threatened punishment, he would stop, supplicate, and seek refuge by virtue of that verse. Another hadith which comes to us from Ibn Abbas that narrates about the Holy Prophet of Islam, Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Whenever the noble messenger recited the verse, Sabbih isma rabbikal a'la, glory the name of your Lord the Most High, Rasulullah would stop, he would respond and say, indeed, glory be to you, my Lord, the Most High. You see, most of us, if we recite, Sabbih isma rabbikal a'la alladhi khalaqa fasawwa walladhi qaddara fahada, and continue on. Not the Prophet, peace be upon him and his family. What he would do is he would stop, he would interact with the verse, he would be conscious of what he's reciting, he would respond, and then he would move on to the second verse so that he understood what he was reciting. He engaged with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Abi Umama narrates from the Holy Prophet of Islam, Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. After his last pilgrimage, the Holy Prophet would frequently recite Surah Al-Qiyamah, chapter number 75 of the Quran, the chapter of resurrection. And when he came to the verse, is Allah, he, not able to give life to the dead? I, Abi Umama, would hear the Prophet stop at the verse and say, yes, indeed, and I am witness that Allah will raise the dead. Now imagine if I was to do that, if we were to do that, we wouldn't be passive in our recitation of the Quran. It would come to life when we were reciting the Holy Quran. Another hadith from Ibn Abbas narrates that when the Prophet would recite the verse, and the soul and he who made it perfect, then he who inspired it to understand what is right and what is wrong, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. When he would come to these verses, Allah, when he would reveal these verses, when the Prophet recited these verses, he would stop and he would say, oh Allah, he would raise his hand, oh Allah, give my soul its inspiration and purify my soul. For you are the best of those who purify it, and you are the Lord and the master of my soul. Again, when I recite these verses, it's just quick, passive. The way the Prophet would recite is he would stop and he would interact with these verses to bring about the reality of it. Another example, when the Prophet would recite from chapter 10, verse 61, the verse, "And you are not engaged in any matter in your life, nor do you recite concerning any part of the Quran, nor do you act anything that you do, except that we are witness over you when you enter into your action," the Prophet would stop and he would weep over those words, remembering that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was witness over his action. Again, the interaction of the Prophet with his Quran. Another example, the hadith from Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. The hadith says, this is the Imam alayhi salam who states, who tells us in this narration, when you finish reciting the chapter of the fig, Surah At-Teen, أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِأَحْكَمِ الْحَاكِمِينَ, Imam Ali alayhi salam tells us, you should testify and say, yes, أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ بِأَحْكَمِ الْحَاكِمِينَ, is Allah not the best of judges? Testify, yes, O Allah, I bear witness, you are the best of judges. This is interacting with the Quran. And another hadith, for example, Imam Ali alayhi salam is narrated to have said, when you read Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 136, you should repeat the ayah and testify to the ayah. We believe in Allah and what He has revealed to us and to Ibrahim and to Ismail and to Ishaq and to their descendants. We believe what was revealed unto Musa and to Isa and the prophets of their Lord. We make no distinction. لا نفرق بين أحد. We do not make any distinction amongst them. And to Allah who do we submit. There are many other examples of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam doing this. The point we wish to emphasize is that when you recite the Quran, let us not recite it quickly for the sake of finishing it. There is little value in doing this. The greatest value is in the methodology, the examples how the Prophet and the Imams used to recite the Quran themselves, and that is that they would interact with the verses. When they came to any verse that talked to them about something that they wished to have for themselves, a pure heart, good children, blessings in wealth, blessings in health, whatever it may have been that was mentioned in the verse, they would stop at the verse, they would raise their hands, and they would supplicate through those words. Now, as we mentioned, this would allow us to improve our tadabbur of the Quran as a foundation technique, because I'm no longer passive when I recite, I am interactive when I recite. That demands, by priority, that if I'm reciting the Quran, I also need to recite it in a language that I understand. For many of us in this hall, we may not know Arabic fluently. Therefore, when I recite the Quran, it requires that I have the translation in the language that I'm most comfortable with. It may be Gujarati, it may be Urdu, it may be English. But the value is in reading and understanding. Reading and understanding, and then interacting with those verses. Number two, why do this? Because if we're going to supplicate, there are no better words to supplicate to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the words of Allah subhanahu. Any parent will tell you, if their child comes up to them and says, "Mom, Dad, you told me to do X, I have done X. I'm asking you to give me X because you told me X or Y," the parent will be happier with that, because it's that words that the child is remembering, they're doing that thing. Now, if you and I come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the same way and say, "My Lord, you mentioned in the Quran about this, I am raising my hands to ask for this," Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not possible for Him to deny you at that moment. All of us have our hajat. Ask for the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and surely you and I will find the best of responses. This is the technique, the foundation technique of tadabbur on Quran. It is interacting with the Quran. And I ask myself and all of us, practice this week, when you recite the Quran, to stop, to be active in the verses, and next week we will talk about another practice of how to ponder upon the Holy Quran, inshallah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Wal Asr. Innal Insana Lafi Khusr. إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين Away to the Savior of Humanity, Imam al-Mahdi alayhi salam, my respected brothers and sisters, salamun alaykum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. There is a report which came out this week from The Guardian and The Observer, which talks about the British government as to its exports of licenses and weapons to the illegal and illegitimate state of Israel. Israel is the last and only apartheid state in the world. It does not have any legal basis for existence. The entirety of it is nothing more than stolen land. We find in the Guardian newspaper and in the Observer the following, that figures reveal this week that British defense firms, of course these are not defense firms, this is just a term to mock the human mind, the figures reveal defense firms' sales are at a new height to the illegal and illegitimate state of Israel. And it reports that this week Prince William prepares for a visit to Jerusalem. It states the following, that the campaign against arms trade has revealed last week that in the last 1 year, the UK has given a record amount of sales in arms licensing to the illegitimate state of Israel, in which this time it has given £221 million worth of arms to Israel. This, of course, would have been used or been present over these last few days and weeks in which our brethren in humanity and brethren in Islam have been seeking their rights. Many of us, we will have seen the massacres that took place. 1,000 killed and many more thousands injured in seeking their rights. For those of you who may not know, the border of the illegal state of Israel, which was being protested against, when they shot these several hundred protesters dead and more thousands injured, they were, and this is a fact, this is not an estimation, this is from the defense force, so-called Israeli defense force figures themselves. Do you know how far away the Palestinian protesters were from the so-called Israeli border? 700 meters away. That's seven football fields. If you want to kick a football from one end to the other, are you able to do it? Seven of those, that's how far away the Palestinian protesters were when they were being gunned down by the terrorist Israeli Defense Force. Children, disabled, and the whole idea was narrated to us that somehow Israel's security was at threat, 700 meters away from their border, of which the British government was responsible for £221 million worth of arms licenses in the last year. It cannot be that 1 week goes and we don't know the realities of what are going on, what our own government is doing, and the following Friday, and especially on the last Friday of the holy month of Ramadan, we will be participating in Al-Quds Day. This is a reminder for us that although things may not be in the front line pages, they may not be in the headlines, it doesn't mean what is happening in Palestine is any less. 98% or 97% of the water is not fit for human consumption. There has been an embargo for several years. People are being massacred. The energy and the energy from its sources are being turned off so that people don't even have air conditioning in the heat of the Arab sun. This is the reality of what is going on. So as we prepare and think about our responsibilities in the coming weeks, especially on Al-Quds Day, I wanted to mention this so that we're not oblivious. We start thinking in advance about what we want to do as a community, how we wish to petition our government to be a more just government, and to support the rights and the return of the Palestinian people back to their homeland and to return back to the things that they have had stolen from them. Inshallah, if we can understand this, this will help us in our preparation for the coming week. When it comes to the visitation of Prince William to make his so-called historic visit, this again is something that we should be campaigning and telling the House of Windsor is unacceptable. It is not acceptable for someone who represents the British people to go to a state and visit another government where crimes of such order have been committed, unless it is going to be for the sake of sincerely trying to bring about a change. And again, hopefully you and I can petition and to demand from the House of Windsor that they will review the visitation of Prince William. Why? Because pressure has worked. In the last few weeks, we have seen many popular speakers, we have seen scientists, we have even seen musicians have revealed that the pressure upon them has worked and that they have boycotted their visitation to the illegal state of Israel. And therefore, if you and I are able to put on the same pressure to Prince William and make our voices heard, then maybe he will do the same thing in his wisdom and his judgment. It just requires you and I to take this as seriously as we hope to, inshallah. Hopefully, if you and I can do this, we can bring about a small effect in the change of the behavior of people towards Israel, and hopefully some justice in the world, inshallah. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi alladhi la ilaha illa huwa al-halimul kareem. Ghafirul dhanbi wa qabirul tawbi wa huwa al-ghafurur rahim. Subhana man sabaqat rahmatuhu ghadabah, mubasat al-yadayni bin rahmah. سبحان من لم يكلف نفسا دون وسعها وعفى عن السيئات ولم يجاز بها سبحان من لا يزداد على معاصي العباد إلا كرما وجودا وعلى كثرة الذنوب إلا عفوا وصفحا نشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العطوف على العباد بجوده والعواد على المذنبين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمد نبيه وحبيبه سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين بعث رحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قائدة الأمم وأولياء النعم ومعدن الرحمة اللهم صل على سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وعلى إمام المسلمين وقائد الغر المحجلين أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه وآله وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين وبدعة خاتم النبيين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء وعلي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام اللهم صل على مولانا صاحب الزمان ما هي آثار البدع والطغيان هادم بنية الشرك والنفاق حاسد فروع البغي والشقاق صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آبائه الكرام اتصل الليالي والأيام اللهم عجل فرجه وسهل مخرجه واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه وتفضل على أمرائنا المؤمنين بمزيد التوفيقات وازدياد الإقبال وعلو الدرجات اللهم افعل بنا ما أنت أهله ولا تفعل بنا ما نحن أهله بجاه محمد وآله المعصومين صلوات الله عليه مجمعين اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى إن الله يأمركم بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون